In this video, we are going to take a quick look at what is involved when we charge and discharge a capacitor. As you may recall, that when you have a voltage across the capacitor, that means that there's a certain amount of charge on the capacitor. In fact, there's a linear relationship between the charge on the capacitor and the voltage, and the constant of that linear relationship is the capacitance, or Q equals CV, is the basic equation we're going to be looking at over and over. To do this, we're going to be looking at the voltage divider a little bit, so I want to review a little bit about the voltage divider before we go forward, because it's going to show up in several places in this discussion. So we're going to be reviewing the voltage divider. We're going to replace a resistor with a capacitor, and we'll make an RC circuit. We're going to be, looking at charging and discharging the capacitor, and then we're going to look at a very interesting device called the 555 timer oscillator, also known as an astable multivibrator, which produces a sequence of pulses which behave like the pulse width modulation, which is used basically as, like, in all cases to control motors for robots and things like that. Okay, several points in this video where you're encouraged to pause and think about a question. To do this, you'll have to press pause in the lower left on your YouTube, on the YouTube window, and then play when you're ready to proceed. This little image right here will occur whenever you're encouraged to stop and think about something. Okay, so but before addressing the voltage divider, we want to recall Ohm's law and point out something that we're going to be using in future classes, particularly when we get to diodes. That is, from Wikipedia, V equals IR, I equals V over R. If you plot the current versus the voltage, which is a very common thing to do, if you have a large resistance, you end up with a line that looks like this, and a small resistance, the line looks like this, because the slope goes as 1 over the resistance. Okay. And so this is just one of those things you want to keep in mind as a way we're going to be looking at things as we go along. And again, it says here, large resistor, small current, small resistor, large current at the same voltage. You can see that from the plot here. And this is the key thing here, and that is whenever we have a big resistor, we're going to have a small current. So if we have a big resistor, and the current is going through that big resistor, it's the ability of that current to charge a capacitor is lower than when the resistor is smaller. Okay, so here's the voltage divider in its most general form, and this is the relationship between the output voltage and the input voltage. Again, the R1 is the resistor on the top and R2 is the one on the bottom, or the resistor we're taking the voltage across. Voltage divider, this formula can be used in other ways. Something that we've actually looked at in the past a little bit, which has to do with the application of the resistive divider, just to show you how flexible it is, that we don't have to actually just use the formula in its usual form as it is up here, but we can solve for Vin in terms of Vout, R1 and R2, or R1 in terms of the other parameters. So really, we can do pretty much anything we want with this expression as long as we know three things, or if we have two unknowns or even more, what experiment can we do to figure out all four parameters? Are there other reasons to make more than one set of measurements? So here we see the little symbol for you to stop and think about this a little bit. So what happens if we have two unknowns or even more? And are there other reasons to make more than one set of measurements? Which sort of gives you a clue as to what happens when you have two unknowns. Okay, now we're back from you thinking about things. Finding an unknown resistor, I've got the setup shown here. The battery is let's assume the battery is a source. The unknowns are Vn and R1. This is a case where we're trying to figure out what the characteristics of the battery are. We measure V out with no R2 connected. That's an open circuit load. And we measure it with some value similar to the value we expect R1 to be. So this is the voltage of the battery, and this is the internal resistance of the battery. We're allowed to change this to be anything we want, and we measure this under two different circumstances, where one where R2 is infinity or an open circuit, when another where R2 is something close to what we think expect R1 to be. Once we do that, we can solve for what R1 is in terms of the battery voltage, the output voltage when there's a load, and the load that's not infinite. Does this answer make sense to you? You can think about it for a little bit and see if, you know, take a look at the values and see if it at least makes plausible intuitive sense. Okay, we're back from thinking. We could use the battery as a source. The unknowns could be R2 and V battery. Use R1 with a value similar to your guess for R2 and so forth. And then here's R2. So it's basically the same equation as before, only things are reversed a little bit. Again, does this answer make sense? Does this make intuitive sense? If V out is much smaller than Vn, or almost the same size as Vn, is that consistent with what you think R2 and R1 should be? Okay, we're back again. Voltage divider, we can also use it to find the input impedance for most black boxes. You can put a divider, you can connect a divider across here. You can also look at the, you can use it for resistive sensors. An example of resistive sensors like the photocell, which looks like this, a strain gauge that looks like this, and a force sensor that looks like this. We'll get back to this again in a second, but as many of you have already picked up a photocell and should do a simple experiment, which I'll explain in just a second. There's a do-it-yourself strain gauge, which actually shows something about how strain gauges really work. You can look at, if you actually just Google DIY strain gauge, you'll find this. And if you notice that if you stretch it this way, the wires become longer, or if you compress it, the wires become shorter and the resistance will change. Okay, so if this is a resistive sensor, then we can use the voltage dividers to play some games with it. Here's an experiment to try. Build a DC voltage divider using a photocell for the bottom resistor. For the upper resistor, choose something whose value is typical for your photocell. So this one is the photocell down here, and you're free to choose what the other one is. Make it something typical of the value of the photocell. Power with a DC source, a battery, a benchtop supply, or the analog discovery DC supply. Connect channel 1 of the analog discovery scope, or use the voltmeter option in analog discovery, and try this voltage divider out in different light conditions. Aim a flashlight at it, aim the bright LED flash from your phone or anything at it, and see how the voltage that's measured across the voltage divider will work for you. I go through this just to remind you that in all these cases of voltage dividers, the main thing that we're looking at is current flowing through here. Okay? And so the bigger the resistance, again, the smaller the current. And for the same current, the bigger the resistance, the larger the voltage. So what is current? And this is where we need to be thinking about what current is a little bit more thoroughly than we have up to this point. Current is charge in motion. Charge is measured in coulombs and represented by the letter Q. Okay, so if you have a constant current where T is the time the current flows, or then the charge that will be traveling past some cross-sectional area here. So we look at the charge that passes this in some time. Well, it's just the current times the time. Okay, so this has the charge as the units of coulombs, current as the units of amps, and so you can see how coulombs and amps are related. So The other thing you recognize is that if you have a certain amount of charge that passes in a certain amount of time, that tells you what the current is. So amps are really just coulombs per second. Okay, so basic idea is that current flowing will move charge from one place to the other. And if current I is flowing for time t, the amount of charge that moves is the product of I times t, and we call that q. So you may want to think about the direction of current relative to the electrons flowing. We've talked about this in previous classes. It's just one of those odd things about the way electricity has been characterized through the years. Okay, so here's what I want to look at. We want to charge a capacitor. Here's the capacitor over here. And you'll notice that this configuration looks like a voltage divider where R1 is still a resistor and R2 is replaced by the capacitor. And here's the voltage supply, which is connected across the resistor and the capacitor at time t equals 0. So this switch closes at t equals 0. All right, when we do that, the voltage on the capacitor starts out at 0 because it has no charge on it. So the voltage on C begins at 0. It's very important to keep in mind. There was no charge on it previously. Nothing was ever connected to it. So the voltage here is 0. Therefore, the voltage from this end of R to this end of R is the same as the voltage from here to here because they're right across from one another. So this, the voltage across the source is basically begins all the way across the resistor, and none of it is across the capacitor. We need current to flow to produce charge on the capacitor. There was no charge on it. We need current to flow to charge it up. So what happens, we get a voltage across the resistor, current is flowing, it begins to charge. As the charge increases, the voltage also increases. And here's the relationship I mentioned before, which is kind of similar to Ohm's law, and that is the charge on a capacitor is related to the voltage by this expression. The charge is equal to C times V. So as the charge increases, the voltage increases, and this will continue until what happens. So think about that for a second, and then start up the video again. All right, so we're charging the capacitor according to this expression right here. The capacitor continues to charge until the voltage from here to here is the same as the voltage from here to here. Once those voltages are the same, then the voltage from this side of the resistor to this side of the resistor becomes 0, and no longer will any current flow. You need a voltage difference across the resistor to have current flow. So the voltage across the capacitor goes up, 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 up until it reaches Vs, and then the current stops and charging stops. We can estimate the time this takes by first assuming that the current never really changes. That's not a good assumption, but we'll see why, that we can kind of correct that in the future. But let's just say remember when we started out, there was no voltage across the capacitor, okay? And all the voltage was across the resistor, and that gave us a current, which was given by the source voltage divided by the resistance. Now, if indeed that was the current for all time, the voltage is Q over C, Q is I times T, and so the voltage is going to look like this. So the time it's going to take is going to be CV divided by I, because that's just rewriting this equation here. Time is CV divided by I, and V over I is R, so the time is R times C. And that's only if the current, and so that would be the shortest possible time it could take for it to charge up, because it's just saying that the voltage all exists across the resistance for all time, which can't really be true, but it's true for a while, so it turns out to be a pretty good way of estimating this. So here's the basic time constant, and it's a term we actually saw in a previous video, which is a characteristic constant for an RC circuit. And it's great that it's such a simple thing. So it says that, you know, if the world was really this simple, that it would take a time RC to charge up the capacitor. Well, it actually takes something similar to RC to charge up the capacitor, as we'll see in a second here. Any questions? One question for you is, does the current actually stay the same as the capacitor charges? Does that make sense to you? So think about it. As the capacitor charges, there will be a voltage across the capacitor, and so it won't stay at zero. It'll begin to increase. All right, in reality, the current does not stay constant, so the charging time is longer, but the capacitor voltage does reach about two-thirds of its value in the time tau equals RC. So here is an actual measurement or simulation of the voltage on a capacitor, and you can see it reaches a little more than 63% of its full value, that is whatever the source voltage is, in a time given by tau. So this is an exact plot of the actual increase, and it shows you that it starts out doing well and increasing really quickly, but eventually it begins to slow down because there's a voltage across the capacitor. So the initial voltage increase reaches, if we had that rate of increase for until it was charged, it would follow up that dashed red curve, and it would be charged fully at time t equals tau. And you can see, actually, the charging begins at that rate down here. So the actual curve is tangent to that in the beginning, and for about half of tau, it follows the line pretty well. And then it begins to diverge from it, ultimately charging slower and slower until it finally reaches the value of the source voltage. Now, you can see that we get practically all the way there, 95% of the way there, in about three time constants. And so the time constant is a very good measure of how long it takes to charge, even though it's not quite as simple as our simple approximation was, where we said the current was the same for all time. So how do you find the current as a function of time? This is actually what we need in order to do this more accurately. Many, many people exploring the properties of circuits have noticed that this RC time constant can be used as a timing standard because it's so reproducible. Here's where I mentioned that we reach 95% of the voltage in three time constants. And what we want to do now is to use the fact that this time constant seems to be characteristic. This RC time constant seems to be characteristic by looking at a circuit which you'll ultimately build, called an astable multivibrator built with a 555 timer chip. And here's the circuit that we're going to be looking at. Here's the 555 timer chip right here. You'll notice if you look carefully that it actually has eight connections to it. It's an eight-pin integrated circuit. You notice we have ground connected to pin one over here, and we have some kind of a voltage source here, which can be anywhere from 5 to 15 volts, connected to pins 8 and pin 4. The output comes from pin 3, and we'll have more to say about that in a little bit. And what really controls its operation are the things that are connected to pin 7, 6, and 2 right over here. What makes this a great little device is that it is a timer circuit. It produces a steady state train of voltage pulses whose timing is determined by the values of R1, R2, and C. It all has to do with the amount of time it takes to charge C1 through these two resistors right here, and also discharge it through R2. I'll explain why we only need to discharge it through R2 in just a second. There's a formula in here for what the timing is and the frequency is, but there's actually a very small error, which I'll remind you about in just a little bit. So what should we connect to the output? If this thing is actually producing a sequence of voltage pulses that look like this right here, where it goes high somewhere near the actual voltage of the power supply and to zero on a regular basis, what would be the most interesting thing to put there? Well, let's look at what it takes to turn on an LED. Typically, to turn on an LED, you need a battery, some kind of a current limiting resistor, and the LED. So we get rid of the battery and we connect it to pin 3 and ground. We basically are going to connect that to here and to ground down here. And so what we're going to be making is a flashing light. Doesn't sound very exciting, but it's actually kind of fun to build and to make the light flash at different speeds depending upon the values of R1, R2, and C. So what's actually going on? Let's look at charging a capacitor. We looked at it a little bit previously. The capacitor in this circuit that I'm showing up here, capacitor C1, which is over here, is charged up by current flowing through R1. And now we're getting to the question that I raised before is, what's the current? The current is determined by R1. So we have a voltage over here and a voltage over here. The voltage on the left is V1, which is shown right here. And the voltage on the right is the voltage on the capacitor. So whenever the voltage on the capacitor is zero, then I is equal to V1 over R1. When the voltage on the capacitor begins to rise as time goes forward up here, the current begins to decrease. V1 is 10, so I've actually, and R1 is 1K in the circuit there. So current is 10 minus the voltage on the capacitor divided by 1K. As the capacitor charges up, its voltage increases and the current charging it decreases. So the rate of charging goes down, and that's what causes this to turn over like this. If the rate stayed the same, it would do what I showed you before, where it just went up by a nice straight line like that. But in this case, it turns over because there's less and less current, so it charges more slowly. If you solve for this, which I've shown previously, the capacitor current looks like this, the capacitor voltage looks like this, and here's the time constant. You can see these things by just doing the simulation. You can do this easily with LTSpice or PSpice or any of the other tools. You just set up the circuit and see how the capacitor charges through a resistor R, and you'll see that it agrees exactly with these expressions. We'll also see how to derive these expressions once we understand something about differential equations. But again, the time constant that shows up here and here is the product of R times C. So everything, the rate of change is really a function of the product of R and C. The bigger the R, smaller the current, the longer it takes to charge up. The bigger the C, the more charge it takes to get to the voltage that you want. It just takes longer to get there. So a bigger capacitor, you need more current. A bigger R gives you less current. Time constant goes up. Note that the voltage rises to a little above 6 volts. If we're going to be going from 10 volts, it goes to a little above 6 volts in 1 millisecond. And that's basically given by this expression. So that's also a way of looking at how you find the time constant. By finding the time it takes to get to about 63% of the voltage. All right, so how does this actually work? At the beginning of the cycle, there's no voltage on the capacitor, but it is charged through resistors R1 and R2. And this charging time constant is R times C. And R in this case is R1 plus R2. So here's the time constant for charging. And this actually shows you what the package looks like if it's the dip. And here's another way of showing what the 555 timer chip looks like. Inside the 555 timer is a device that actually pays attention to what the voltage is. on these on this on pins 2 and 6. All right. When the voltage on the capacitor reaches the two-thirds of the VCC, which is the value we're using for the power supply, what happens then is that inside of the box there is a switch, and this gets connected to ground. So this pin here will get grounded, and at that point the capacitor begins to discharge. So when it reaches this point, it takes a time, which is about 70% of the time constant. It doesn't go, we're not talking about how much time it takes to get to the entire voltage or half of it or whatever it might be, to get to about 70% of it. That's the time constant it takes to get up to about it's about 70% of the time constant to get about two-thirds of the voltage. All right, as soon as that switch is closed, the capacitor discharges through pin 7. And inside it, again, it's being monitored. The voltage here on the capacitor is being monitored until it drops to one-third of the power supply voltage, at which point the switch is open and the cycle starts over. The capacitor voltage cycles back and forth, so it drops to the value of one-third, so it charges up to two-thirds, drops to the value of one-third, goes back up to two-thirds, down to one-third, and back and forth. So every time it hits two-thirds, the switch closes, and every time it hits one-third, the switch opens. Cycle starts over. If you combine those two time constants, you see that you've got, this is the charging time and this is the discharging time. And so the entire time constant will be the sum of those two. And if you look really carefully up here, you notice that these terms up here, when you add up for the frequency, you end up, it's showing as 1 over R1 plus R2, but there should actually be there should be a 2 in front of the R2 in that expression. We'll see it in another formula coming up in a second. So the general idea again is we charge the capacitor, we discharge the capacitor, we charge it, we discharge it. This happens with a completely predictable time, and therefore we're able to use this in order to set the timing of this device. So ultimately here's the frequency, which then shows the error in the figure. Instead of the 0.693 and the constants on the bottom, you move it up to the top and you get 1.44. And so this tells you the kind of frequency that you can make. So if you want it to pulse once a day, once a second, whatever, you just pick values for R1, R2, and C1 to make that happen. Okay, so what's actually happening inside? Excuse me, you'll notice that there is a voltage divider with 3 5K resistors. And so the voltage here is the supply voltage, and let's say it's 9 volts, just for an example. And over here is ground. And so if you have 3 resistors here, you'll have 3 volts there, and you'll have 6 volts there. It's not drawing very well here for me. So let's actually get rid of that so it doesn't have to look so terrible. Okay, so here and here we have 3 volts and 6 volts because the 3 5 volt resistors divide the 9 volts into equal amounts, or 3 volts across each resistor. And then all the rest of this circuitry here, which we'll learn a little bit about on later in the course, that has a comparator, a flip-flop, and an output driver, which checks to see what the voltages are and then makes a decision and flips a switch. It's really basically all it does. And if you have questions about this, don't hesitate to ask, but this is a good point to stop and think about it. And while you're watching this, write down those questions and ask them in class or post them on Piazza. So the 555 timer produces a sequence of square voltage pulses. The frequency can be selected. The length of the on time and the length of the off time can also be selected. Square pulses with varying on and off times are what we use to create pulse width modulation. And this is used to vary the average voltage delivered to a load. So what is pulse width modulation? It's just a good thing to introduce this a little bit at this point. Here's pulse width modulation. You can see that it's possible to produce square pulses with different average values. This one is on 50% of the time, this one is on 75% of the time, this one is on 25% of the time. Almost all computer control uses some form of PWM. We can use this to control lights, and in fact the dimmers for LED lights and other things like that are all done with pulse width modulation, but we run them fast enough so you can't actually see the flicker. So a question to think about is, what is the average for each duty cycle? It should be fairly obvious what it is in each case, but you can see that the average is different for each one. So if you're delivering a different amount of average energy, then if those are controlling motors or lights or anything like that, then the average energy delivered to those devices is varying this way. And this is a much easier to control than something where you actually just change the voltage between, like, say 0 and 5 volts or 0 and 10 volts. By having it on half the time and off half the time, it's much easier to do that than to just deliver half the voltage. Okay, so there's you can find all kinds of stuff online. I mean, there's many circuits to build. Here's a nice clean circuit over here showing how the device is connected. One warning I'd make, just so you don't mix yourself up, is that the pin numbers are not shown in sequence here. You notice there's 1, 5, 3, 8, 4. And if we remember previously, the pins go around this way on the chip from 1 to 8. And so you have to be careful to count properly. And on the chip, look for the little dimple here. It's also shown over here as a reference to where you'll find pins 1 and 8. Okay, and here's another sheet showing all the formulas kind of all in one place. So you're free to make it do just about what you want. You can change the duty cycle, you can change the frequency, you can change the on time and the off time. All of those are basically equivalent. So at this point, we'd like to build one and have some fun with it. And so you should now take a look at the experiment that's been laid out with the 555 timer. Build it and try it with different components in it to see how you can actually control the pulses that are being produced. And in this case, you want to monitor the output voltage. Just show back here. You want to monitor the output voltage and the voltages at pin 7 and pin 6 in order to verify how it's working. You can't measure three things at once with analog discovery, so you want to do the output and 6 and then the output and 7 and then have two plots so that you have enough information to see how it works. So that's it, and we will see you in class.